Okay, so thank you. That was great. And so the next session is going to be focusing on new developments and methods for calculating spectroscopic properties. And this session was nominally chaired by Lucia Reining, but unfortunately Lucia couldn't make it this time. She got ill at the last minute. So I'm going to sub in. And this session, as you probably noted on your program, we discussed earlier this morning, also included Frank Nice originally. So it's going to start off with Jan Wilhelm. And before Jan comes up, let me just say a couple of words, and then I'll keep it short so that we're on track. But basically, for many properties of materials, phenomena of interest, excited states are very relevant and important. So in other words, beyond ground state, properties are important. So this session is going to deal with, in particular, charged and neutral excitations. Those are kinds of excitations that can be measured with, say, photoemission or scanning tunneling microscopy and spectroscopy, or by absorption of photons through linear absorption optical spectroscopy. And so in those kinds of methods, the formalism that has become increasingly standard in its application in the solid state and condensed phase has been many-body perturbation theory. And so there, the GW, that basically is a Green's function-based formalism that goes that at for charged excitations involves the GW approximation, and for neutral two-particle excitations, the Bethe-Salpeter equation approach. And so a lot of advances in those two methods in the last few years have led to some very interesting calculations and methodologies, and yet we're still, I think in an early stage in those approaches. And so the three talks in this session are going to be covering advances, recent advances in our ability to compute accurately and predict these spectroscopic properties. And so maybe I'll just mention a couple of things. For example, in GW, those calculations are, tend to be quite accurate and predictive, but they're much more computationally demanding than a DFT calculation. And that's because one has to construct the polarizability, and that's kind of an end of the four nominally requires end of the four operations. And so one of our speakers is going to be talking about constructing that polarizability at a much lower computational cost. Another issue in GW and Bethe-Salpeter calculations right now are the use of pseudopotentials. One has to use those with great care and construct those with great care. And which electrons you treat as valence and which you freeze in the core can affect your calculations. And so the second speaker is going to be focusing on using all electron methods for calculating spectroscopic properties. That also gives you access to core level excitations, which can be measured at most synchrotrons. So that's quite important. And then finally, many of the calculations of band gaps and optical properties only indirectly treat the effect of temperature or don't treat it at all. And so the final talk in our session is going to be focused on methods to better calculate the effect of temperature on optical excitations. And so I think with that, I'll pass it to our first speaker, who's Jan Wilhelm from BASF. And Jan, I will give you a warning at 20 minutes, but you have 25 minutes and then 5 minutes for questions. So.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thanks to the organizers for this kind invitation to this nice conference. So all the stuff I will show you about the slow scanning GW has been, or the work has been done back at the university and in my free time, so it's not connected to BASF actually. So I would like to start giving a quick introduction into GW. It's very sketchy, so it's maybe not really rigorously, but maybe you can get some tidy ideas. So we are interested in computing energy levels of a molecule or a material, and such an energy level is defined as, for example, bringing here an electron from some states to the vacuum level, and the energy of this level is then this energy difference. And also, you can there is a definition for unoccupied states. The energy is the energy you would get if you would bring an electron from the vacuum level to an unoccupied level. So if you, now it's a question how you can compute these energy levels of a molecule or a material, and you could look in the literature and find the self-consistent field equation of DFT. So you see all the molecular wave functions, and every wave function is corresponded with an eigenvalue epsilon n. So you could now take these epsilon n's for the energy levels, but this is not the correct procedure, so there is not a guarantee, no theorem that says that these epsilon n's are really connected to energy levels. Instead, if you dig deeper in the literature, you will find that instead, if you put in a self-energy sigma, which has two space coordinates, r and r prime, instead of the exchange correlation potential, and is energy dependent, then if you solve this equation, the Schrödinger type equation, you get exact energy level. So this is still not the full truth. It's a bit sketchy, but you can see the difference between these two equations. In the literature, you will also find a formula for computing sigma. These are called Higgins equations, but they are extremely complicated to evaluate. Therefore, people normally do approximations to sigma. And one very popular approximation, as Professor Neaton already said, is a GW approximation to sigma. It's called it because you evaluate sigma as a product of the Green's function and the Green-Coulomb interaction. The only problem now arises that in G, you need all eigenvalues or all energy levels and all the wave functions, and it's the same for W. So that means you should also solve this equation here self-consistently by just first getting some epsilon n and psi n as input, then computing a sigma, solve it again, and computing a new sigma. This is computationally also very expensive. Therefore, people normally do the Chingon-Dabingon approximation. That means they do a DFT calculation, then they get epsilon n's and psi n's, so these ones here from DFT, they plug in to them to G and to W, so here, then they get a self-energy, and then they evaluate these eigenvalues newly. And you also take the DFT wave functions from the SCF. So this is also a bit sketchy, but as I said in G and W not, you take wave functions and eigenvalues from DFT and you just update them once. There are several types of self-consistency in GW. I will use eigenvalue self-consistent GW in the following, which has been shown to give good results for molecules. And in this eigenvalue self-consistent GW, you once compute these G and W and eigenvalues, then you plug them again here into W and G, you get a new sigma here, and then you re-evaluate the GW eigenvalues, and you do this until you reach convergence. So now, as Professor Niedner also already said, that the most expensive step in a GW calculation is actually computation of the density response function chi. And not in a normal GW code, one is doing that in imaginary frequency. And in such a computation scales is n to the 4, which is with the system size due to the following reason. So if you double the system size and you have a real space grid, all the real space points r are doubled. This is the same for r prime, so you have already n square. And then you have to sum over all occupied and over all unoccupied molecular orbitals, and each of them are also scaling linearly with the system size if you increase it. So if you add all this up, you have r, r prime, I and a, it's n to the 4 scaling. All following steps, computing the w, g, and and epsilon, and also sigma, they are all n to the 4 steps. So now it has been already found 20 years ago that there is a better scaling method, which is called GW space-time method, and the time you see here. So And the reason is you could Fourier transform this function here from frequency to time. And if you do it, you see that it's now a product of an eigenvalue epsilon I times a function of an eigenvalue of epsilon A. That means you can split up this sum here into these two parts because everything is separated. And in this way, you first can sum over all occupied orbitals. This is the n2-3 step because it's number of occupied orbitals, r and r prime, here r prime and r, and you can execute a sum over unoccupied orbitals. Separately, each step is n2-3, and the final summation is here a function of r and r prime, another function of r and r prime. This is only n square. So you brought down the scaling from n2-4 from here to n2-3. And then you evaluate this polarizability on several time points, and then you do the back Fourier transform numerically, and then you obtain here the density response in imaginary frequency. And in this way, you get n2-3 scaling. So now there's a bit of an issue if you go to a plane wave basis set, where normally GW codes for the solids are done in plane waves. The problem is, you see here, the density response in a plane wave basis set. And for this, you have to Fourier transform the R index to G. So you have here an R index, there an R index. And if you Fourier transform it, you get such matrix element because it's an integral over R, and this is this matrix element. So you coupled again occupied and unoccupied molecular orbitals, and that means you cannot separate this summation anymore, although here the function could be separated. So in plane waves, you actually couldn't implement this space-time method in a good scaling way. This GW space-time method has been implemented in WASP, and they use also real space grids for the Green's function. So this is one Green's function, this is another one, and they compute it on a real space grid and do Fourier transform back to get a chi in plane waves. But the problem is that real space grids are not an optimal way for representing electronic structure calculations, and therefore it could be maybe better to find a better localized basis for chi which is local, so a local basis, and still efficient. And this could be maybe done by a Gaussian basis set. So here all molecular orbital wave functions are expanded in a Gaussian basis. So these are atom-centered functions. And if you then write down all the GW space-time method, which is very similar also in Hartree-Fock, you get four-center Coulomb integrals over Gaussian basis functions. So these are all Gaussians, and you have to evaluate them. And in quantum chemistry, there is a very often used trick, which is called the resolution of the identity. So you introduce another Gaussian basis set, which is abbreviated as this with P, and actually the identity operator is approximated by this Gaussian basis set, and there is this inverse overlap matrix appearing because the Gaussian basis set is not orthogonal. Now you insert this identity equation twice in the four-center Coulomb integrals, once here, then you project these mu mu functions onto P. This is just this three-center overlap integral. You get the inverse overlap matrix here. Then you project Q on the Coulomb operator, and then you insert again the identity here between the Coulomb operator and lambda. You get another RI index and inverse overlap matrix and another projection, a three-center projection. So the cool thing is now that this three-center projection is sparse in space. So that means only if all three Gaussian basis functions are close together, then this integral has a value, which is not zero. But as soon as one of these three Gaussian basis functions is far away from the others, the integral is zero because the Gaussian basis is decaying as e to the minus r square in distance. So the integral is zero because you only integrate zeros up here. So now the whole algorithm, if you use a Gaussian basis set for the molecular orbitals and this resolution of the identity is written here. So first you see that one computes the Green's function in the Gaussian basis in imaginary time. Then the next step is the computation of the density response, which is now in this resolution of the identity bases, which is local. Now here, it's crucial to have a good scaling. And the good scaling you can see in the following. So we focus on the sum over nu. And first you get an n square scaling because the screens function here has two indices, nu and sigma. So we already have n square scaling. But for every nu here, we only have very limited numbers of mu and very limited numbers of q functions. Only these functions which are close to nu. Only these functions contribute, all other integrals are zero. And if you increase the system size, then you add only functions which are far away from nu. So you don't have to consider more mu and q. And this means that you only have an n-square scaling actually coming from nu and sigma indices. It's the same for the sum over lambda. And you can also show that the sum over nu and sigma has also n-square scaling. So all following steps are just simple matrix-matrix multiplications, and they scale as n to the 3 with the system size. The computation of sigma is again n square. If you would look exactly at it, then one makes a Fourier transform from time to frequency again. One also has to do an analytic continuation from imaginary frequency to energy, and then finally one gets the GW eigenvalues. So now, how big can we now go with this algorithm? Here on the left, the homolumo gap of such molecules here, graphene nanoribbons, and they have been recently synthesized on gold surfaces, so it's not an idealized system. One really needs GW calculations on these types of molecules. And on the right, you see this, the length of the ribbon. Actually, we increase the length of these ribbons. And shown is the gap of all transport states in the middle. So there are also zigzag states here, which actually are HOMO and DUMO, but I neglect them. I only look at the transport gap of middle states. And you see the HOMO-LUMO gap here on the left. So it slowly converges. So one really has to go to large ribbons to actually have a converged HOMO-LUMO gap of these ones. And the value where it's converging to is also matching to a periodic ribbon here, that one, which has been already published 10 years ago. So on the right here, you see the computational cost. So the execution time is written here in node hours. So for example here, 10 to the 3 node hours means that the computation could be run, for example, on 100 nodes for 10 hours. The blue dots here are an n to the 4 implementation, so with imaginary frequency. And it's typical that these implementations are limited to several hundreds of atoms. And instead, the green dots here, which are this imaginary time cubic scaling algorithm, here I could go to 1,700 atoms, so it's more than here. And the reason is that one is an eigenvalue self-consistent GW calculation, and here it's only Jing or W naught, and this could be still afforded with Jing or W naught. If you make such a double logarithmic plot, so here logarithm, and you can measure the slope, you get the computational scaling, and the scaling is actually n to the 2.1, so it's close to n square. That means all the cubic scaling steps, so all n3 steps, they have to be cheaper, and this is also indeed like this. So the brown points are all n to the 3 scaling steps, and they are the computational cost is much below than the n-square scaling steps. Good. So some words about the accuracy. You could say the imaginary time and imaginary frequency, back transform, force and back could introduce some issues. So the benchmark has been done for the GW100 test set, which has been published some years ago. And you see here the count, the number of molecules, which deviate here, for example, by 0.02 electron volts from reference values. And this is done for the HOMO level in Jing on W naught. And you see that it would be, of course, perfect if 100 molecules would be here, 0.0. But you actually see that somehow 15 molecules are deviating more than 0.06 electron volts. And it's mostly due to the imaginary time, imaginary frequency transforms. But the good thing is you can check it whether you are accurate or not by just increasing the number of time or frequency points. So you can charge whether your calculation is good or bad. And for the lowest unoccupied molecular orbitals, it's even a bit better. Good. So far, I only talked about molecules. And I also did some ideas on periodic GW calculations with this algorithm. And for this, I would evaluate the Green's function at a gamma point and also compute the density response at the gamma point. And as soon as you have a very large box, due to the locality of the Gaussian basis functions, you can reintroduce k points from the gamma-only results, but this only works if the box is very large. And then finally, you also include the Coulomb operator with k points. Yeah, and you go through, and also the Green-Coulomb interaction you get in k points, but then you have to do some, one has to do some minimum image convention, which is also done in periodic Hartree-Fock calculations, and one inserts it here, and this also only works for very large supercells. So I don't want to go into details here because it's getting very technical, and it's not. And the code works for 5 weeks now, so it's not like it's super urgent to go into details. I just want to show that one can go in principle big with the with this algorithm. So I picked an interface between an Angatas 100 surface and a 001 surface. It has been discussed in the literature that if you take Angatas and rutile mixed interfaces, that then catalytic activity of this system is much enhanced compared to poor Angatas or poor rutile. And this interface here has in total 1,000 atoms. I use pseudopotentials for it, 4.4.4 K-point mesh. Typically, one says that in an augmented double zeta basis, or in this system, or in this case, the double zeta basis augmented is converged, converges the gap to 0.05 electron volts. It's much electrons. And here on the right, you see the local density of states of the system computed with GW. So one takes the GW, not eigenvalues, and then smears it with smears it a bit and sums it up, and one also projects it then on this on the axis of the interface. So it's here this integration. And then, for example, one can see that if here an electron is excited in Angatas, here from the occupied states to the valence states, then an electron here from rutile can fall into this hole, and the hole is here, and the electron here, so you separate electrons and holes, and this causes, and now electrons and holes cannot quickly recombine anymore because they are separated, and it enhances catalytic activity because you have many electrons and many holes in the material. So it is, so it has been found in experiments that actually this level alignment here between Angatas and rutile was 0.5 electron volts, so it somehow matched experiments. But of course, there is much to do, so one has to do more efficient K-point integration. This is not yet fully converged with K-points. Also, one could do all electron calculations because there is no actually need for pseudopotential. One has to do benchmarks, how big this cell has to be, and finally, it would be, of course, cool to have a set of basis sets you can do to do routine calculations. So now I would like to show finally an application of GW to acene molecules. They are still small, so the application has been done with the n⁴ scaling code. There is actually a cool rule from organic chemistry for these molecules, namely that the resonance structure with the largest number of aromatic pi sextet is most important for these molecules. So what does it mean? If you look at this small molecule called phenantrein, you can draw many of resonance structures, and then you mark the rings where you have three of these bonds. And then you draw a circle. You can do it many ways, and you can also do it like this, that you have two circles here. And now this Klar rule says that this structure here with the two rings is much more important for the properties of this molecule than that one. And in chemistry, this is then, for example, you can show or you can measure that if you want to do a reaction, this double bond here is much more reactive than the double bonds in here. So this is the foundation for chemistry. And in the acene molecules, you actually always only can draw one of this ring. So in anthracene, I show it here, you can only draw, you can draw the ring on every position, and then people say this is a migrating sextet because this sextet here can be on every position. And if you make the acene longer and longer, it's always the same. So you only can draw one of these rings, and this can be on every position. So now the cool thing is that you can also introduce unpaired electrons. So like here, and then you can draw two of these sextets, so one here and one here. And now it's the question, yeah, is it now two sextets and two unpaired electrons, or it can be even four of these sextets? So we don't know, or is it maybe even this structure here, so closed shell without any unpaired electrons? So this was the motivation. Are these acenes actually closed shell like this, or are they open shell with unpaired electrons? And the problem until now was always that these molecules are very unstable for long acenes are very unstable. And recently at EMPA, they have been able to synthesize heptacene and longacene on a gold surface by some fundamental chemistry reaction. And now they also can measure the homo-lumo gap of these molecules by scanning tunneling spectroscopy. So they make, as also Professor Neaton said, an experiment, and they can probe here the homo level and the LUMO level. Of course, it's not extremely extremely well-defined, but they can measure here the distance between HOMO and LUMO, and in this way, they can get the HOMO-LUMO gap. And now, one can plot the HOMO-LUMO gap as function of the number of the acene rings. So you see here, this is the measurement from EMPA, and this is the other one. And also last year, luckily, there were the acene with 10 and 11 rings was also synthesized on the gold surface, so there are also points. And now one can do a GW calculation with the closed shell molecule and with an open shell molecule. But singlet, so you always have a total spin of zero. And here you see, and it's now a guess phase computation in GW, and one takes into account the gold surface by the an image charge model, which has also been done by Neaton. And in this way, you get, so these blue points here are the open shell HOMO-LUMO gaps, the magenta points are the closed shell ones, and you see that the trend is following somehow the open shell gaps, so the distance is always actually the same. And the reason here for this drop is actually a symmetry change in HOMO and LUMO close to between 10 and 11 rings. And this has been already published before in literature, and we would say that this drop is absent in the experiments. So we, and also, the open shell gaps are well matching to the experimental ones, so we could have, so this could indicate that the acene molecules are actually open shell on the gold surface. So I showed you a low scaling GW implementation, which scaled as n to the square with the system size. One could go to 1,700 atoms. And in the last part, I showed you the acene example where we thought that the acenes are probably open shell on a gold surface. So I would like to talk, I would like to acknowledge Jörg, who supervised my PhD, and Dorothea, Carlo, Roman, and Leopold for the nice collaborations on GW implementations and the nanoribbons and acenes. The funding has been whole, or my whole PhD has been funded with Marvel, and also several, computation time has been funded by Marvel, and all has been implemented in CP2K, so it's open source, and one can use it. And I thank you for your kind attention.